Hello, and thank you for joining this presentation. My name is Emilien Maco. I am a PhD student at HEC Paris, and today I'm going to present you a joint work with Marco Scarsini and Tristan Tomala, which deals with Bayesian learning in dynamic non-atomic routing games. The starting point of our paper is the following observation. In most routing environments, whether you consider traffic routing or internet routing, some important changes may happen on the cost or latency functions. For instance, in the context of traffic routing, one may think about car accidents or roadworks, which may slow some streets down or even cut them completely from the routing graph. Of course, such changes have a strong impact on equilibrium behavior, yet they may be unknown. And the presence of incomplete information on such changes can then induce strong inefficiency at equilibrium. Moreover, if we model these situations using large games, there is a natural presence of myopic behavior, which will preclude exploration of the action set over the course of the game. In this paper, we try to answer the following question. What are the conditions required on the premises of the game, such that in the long run, there is an efficient information aggregation by a non-strategic and public information system? That is, an information system that will gather information, transmit it to agents, without being able to manipulate it or create any sort of incentive. To model this, we include the following elements. First, we consider a model of incomplete information. There will be one state of the world, which will be drawn ex ante from a finite state space and according to a commonly known prior distribution. Then, we will consider rational learning heuristics in that we are interested in the evolution of a Bayesian belief. Then, we will consider a repeated framework, that is, our game will be played at discrete time steps, but using dynamic populations. From one stage to the other, a new player set will be drawn. Finally, we consider a model of symmetric information. There is one common public history, and every bit of information is accessible by everyone and contained in this history. So there is no such thing as private information. Now, if you combine all these elements together, you define a game in which you have a joint dynamics between beliefs and equilibria. And the whole question then is to study these dynamics. How do they behave? Do they converge? And if they do, where? And in our paper, we're able to show the following things. First, we prove that these dynamics do converge. They converge to some specific rest point, which looks very similar to conjectural equilibria. But we show that in the long run, the limit belief needs not converge to the truth. And actually, some optimal path may remain unused in the long run. We show also that efficient learning depends on several elements, which include the graph topology, but also the presence of some exogenous source of randomness in the game. In our approach, we decide to use variable demand. That is, from one stage to the other, the demand mass entering the graph will be random and variable. Finally, we are able to identify necessary and sufficient conditions to ensure that in the long run, there is efficient learning in the context of a variable demand. So let me skip the literature review to introduce you to the canonical routing game framework. So, a non-atomic routing game consists in a tuple D, N, and a set of functions CE, in which D is a non-atomic demand mass. You can think of it as the Lebesgue measure of a continuous player set. We have a routing graph N, of which capital E will be the finite edge set. The graph will be directed and will contain a single origin node and a single destination node. And we will note by capital R the set of paths connecting the origin to the destination. But this will be the set of actions available to players. Finally, for each edge in the graph, there will be a continuous and non-decreasing cost function associated, which will map the mass of agents using this edge to a cost in R+. Now, this model transfers smoothly to an incomplete information framework considering the following addition. We will first add capital theta, which will be a finite state space. And mu, we will be a full support distribution on Capital Theta. At the beginning of the game, one state of the world will be drawn ex ante according to this distribution. And now, for each edge E in the graph, the cost function CE will depend both on the mass of agents using this edge and on the state of the world. We note such a game GD mu as its equilibrium only depends on the demand mass and the prior distribution. Now, when a demand enters such a graph and routes over it, it generates what we call a flow on path, and we note it X. This flow corresponds to a splitting of the demand mass over the different path connecting the origin to the destination. Such a flow generates on each edge what we call a load. And a load will be simply the sum of all the flows of every path containing the considered edge. Now, using this edge, we'll generate for everyone a cost CE of LE, the load of the edge, and theta, the state of the world. And the cost of taking a full path from the origin to the destination will be the sum of the cost of every edge contained in that path. As a solution concept, under complete information, we consider wardrobe equilibria. And a flow on a graph will be a wardrobe equilibrium if every path that receives some positive mass will be a cost minimizer, and of course, the summation of every flow on every path will equal the original demand. Now, this solution concept also transfers smoothly to incomplete information, to what we call a base wardrobe equilibrium. And a base wardrobe equilibrium will simply be the wardrobe equilibrium for the game played with the expected cost functions under a given belief. So every path that receives a positive flow at equilibrium will be an expected cost minimizer. So we consider a repeated framework, which works as follows. We consider discrete time steps, and originally, a state of the world will be drawn according to the prior distribution mu zero. Then at each stage of the game, a new demand mass will be drawn according to a common knowledge cumulative distribution, capital F, and will route across the graph. Before they route, players perfectly observe the demand of the day, but they also observe a public history, HT, which will contain all the information available from past plays. It will contain the demand masses, the load profiles on every edge, and the costs that were endured at every stage. Information in our model is perfectly public, and every agent shares the same belief, mu t of theta, which will correspond to the conditional probability of such state given the original belief mu zero and the current history ht. We're interested in learning in this paper, and throughout we will have to distinguish between two forms of learning. The first form, which we call strong learning, corresponds to the theoretical approach to learning. And we will say that there is strong learning in the game where the belief, the public belief mu t, will converge to a full mass on the true state of the world. That is, agents perfectly unravels what the state is. But this may not be the case, and yet it can happen that agents behave correctly in the game. This is why we introduce a weaker notion of learning, which we call weak learning, that will happen when, in the long run and for the limit belief, agents play as if they were under full information. Finally, to simplify the exposition, we will make two assumptions. The first assumption requires that for every state theta and every edge E, the cost function CE given the state theta is strictly increasing. This is not a necessary assumption, and our results works even if we don't use it, but it guarantees unicity of the equilibrium edge load profiles, so it simplifies the presentation of our results. If this hypothesis would not hold, we could consider a public equilibrium selection system without any problem. The second assumption we make is that for every pair of states, there is an edge and a load for which the cost functions differ in those two states. And the reason we make this assumption is simply to rule out trivial cases where strong learning would never occur because the two states are perfectly indistinguishable. Let me now introduce you to the different results we have and give you some intuitions on how we prove them. The first result we were able to prove is that in any such dynamic and non-atomic routing game, under the assumption A1, the sequence of equilibrium load profiles converges to a limit map L infinity in finite time and with probability 1. So this is a strong convergence result, which follows from Martingale convergence theorems. Indeed, we have a finite state space and a deterministic observation regime, meaning that in the long run, our belief converges in finite time. One way to think about this result is also to realize that the sequence of supports of belief is actually weakly decreasing. Why is that? Well, it's because every time your belief evolves, it's because you delete some states as being incompatible with the observations you had. So every time you learn something, it's actually because you delete some state from the support of your belief. So beliefs converge, and the equilibrium map do converge too, but it need not converge to the truth. And for that, we have a simple counterexample, which I will show you. Consider two states, a good state, which we know G, and a bad state, which we know B. And consider the following graph. There is one origin and one destination, and two edges parallel. On the upper pass, there is a cost which depends on the state of the world. If the state is good for a given load L, the cost on this edge will be L. But if the state is bad, there will be a premium constant cost, A. On the lower pass, the cost does not depend on the state of the world and will always be equal to the load on that edge. In this example, you have the following result, which is that learning occurs in the dynamic game in both strong and weak sense, if and only if there is a strictly positive probability that the demand goes beyond A times mu zero of B. Why is that? It's that because if the demand is below this level, then it will be strictly dominated to go on the upper pass, because of the possibility that the state is bad and that agent will have to pay an additional cost A. So they will prefer to go on the lower pass, and if no agent ever goes on the upper pass, no learning can occur. So myopic behavior in this situation does not incentivize exploration. And the way we find that to compensate this lack of incentive is to use the demand. That is, if the demand can push agents using the upper pass, then there will be learning in this case. But if not, then learning will not happen. Before telling you about our main result, let me introduce a bit of definitions from graph theory. Indeed, our main theorem requires the routing network to belong to a certain class of graphs, which are called series parallel graphs. The usual definition of series parallel graphs is the following. A single origin and destination graph with a single edge will be a series parallel graph. Then, any graph consisting in two series parallel graphs connected in series will be series parallel, and every graph consisting in series parallel graphs being connected in parallel will also be series parallel. So you have a constructive definition of this class. While it is easy to understand the nature of such graphs, it may be a bit difficult to visualize. And so let me show you the following characterization of series parallel graphs. A graph is series parallel if and only if none of its topological minors, that is, embedded structures within your graph, are of the Wheatstone network type. That is, if you consider the undirected equivalent of your graph, if ever by deleting some edge or cutting some nodes you end up with such a structure, then your graph is not series parallel. All right, now let me show you our main theorem. Consider any demand distribution with an unbounded support, then under our two earlier assumptions, weak learning occurs for any set of unbounded cost functions if and only if the routing network is series parallel. So what's the intuition behind this result? It's It's all about using the variations of the demand as a tool to incentivize exploration of the network. And let me first show you that indeed, if I have all these assumptions, then I have learning with probability one. This all rests on the following lemma, which tells you that if you have a series parallel graph and unbounded cost functions, then for every belief, there exists a demand threshold such that if you go beyond this demand threshold, then you will have a positive load on every edge of the graph. So this is a strong result, which guarantees that if our demand goes high enough, there will be agents everywhere in our graph at equilibrium. Now, with an unbounded demand support, then there is a positive probability that some flows will use every edge in our graph in the long run. But now, what if there are two states that we can't distinguish? Because the state of demands whose flows will give different costs in those two states has probability zero. Well, we show that this is not a problem, because in that case, it must be that those two states belong to the support of the limit belief, meaning that equilibrium loads in those two states are perfectly identical for any value of the demand. That means that those two states, given the demand support, cannot be distinguished, but that it's not important because weak learning occurs. Agents behave as if they were in those two, in any of those two states, they would behave in the same way. And as the limit belief always includes the truth, then there will be weak learning almost surely. Now, let me show you the reverse statement, which is consider a non-series parallel network. And we will show that then we can find an assignment of costs and a prior beliefs, such that there is no learning in the long run. So if a network is not series parallel, let me remind you that it must contain somehow the Wheatstone network as a graph minor. Now, what we do in this paper is to start from this Wheatstone network and find an assignment of costs such that there will be no learning in the long run. And we do that by finding some costs such that on the vertical edge connecting nodes A to B, the edge E3, there will be no load for any value of the demand ever. Consider two states, theta 1 and theta 2, consider epsilon and A2 positive values, then for the following cost combination, there is no learning in this Wheatstone network. In fact, on every edge except edge 3, the costs do not differ given the state of the world, and on edge 3, either you are in state 1 in which you have a cost epsilon L, or you are in state 2 and you have a cost A plus epsilon L. And what we show is that there will be a positive load on edge E3 at equilibrium only if 1 minus the load L3 is bigger than A times mu 0 of theta 2. That is the premium you pay in the bad state. And so all we have to do is choose both A and the prior belief mu 0, so that A times mu 0 of theta 2 is bigger than 1. Now, what we have to do is to reconstruct our original graph from its minor. We use graph minor properties. Indeed, a graph can be reconstructed from its minor by applying the following operations sequentially. Either splitting an edge into two edges and a middle node, or adding a new edge in your graph, or extending the origin or the destination by an edge. And if you combine all these three operations sufficiently many times, you can reconstruct your graph from any of its minors. What we do is that we apply some rules on how cost would evolve according to each of these operations to ensure that the fact that no one would ever use the edge E3 will remain true. So if we split an edge into two edges and a middle node, what we do is that we have the costs on each of those new edges. If we have to extend the origin or the destination by another edge, then on this edge we apply a linear cost C of L equals L in any state. And it's a bit more difficult, if we add a new edge, Then what we do is we also impose a linear cost, CL, C of L and theta equals L in any state. But if this edge belongs to any path connecting nodes A to B, that is the upper and lower node of our vertical edge E3, then we multiply the cost of every edge in this path by the number of edges of the shortest path from A to B. And if we do so, I will not prove you completely, then we know that there will be no agent using all this middle edge and every path you can create subsequently. And so that in the long run, there will be no learning, either weakly nor strongly. But let me talk briefly about strong learning, because we introduced the definition. And actually, we are able to identify the conditions under which you have strong learning instead of weak learning. And this is all a consequence of the proof of our main theorem. Namely, if you consider any demand distribution with an unbounded support D, then under the hypothesis of our main theorem, strong learning will occur for any set of unbounded cost functions if and only if the support of the demand D corresponds to R plus. So this is a direct consequence of the proof of our main theorem. And what happens is that if D is R plus, is equal to R plus, then we show that equilibrium loads on every edge of the game will be continuous surjections from R plus to R plus, which guarantees that the cost functions will be explored at sufficiently many different points, such that given we have a finite state space, then we have strong learning in the long run. It's not possible that there are two states belonging to the limit belief. And that concludes the result section of our presentation. So let me conclude by doing a small recap. So in this paper, what we did first was establishing a model of dynamic routing games with symmetric information, including all the elements I showed you. And then what we showed is that in such games, players do not have incentives to explore. And then what happens is that usually they don't learn. So you can have arbitrarily high losses of efficiency at equilibrium over the course of the dynamic game. And so what we show is that if we consider unbounded demand, then for any class of cost functions, we have learning in the game if and only if the routing networks belong to this specific class of series parallel networks. And we will have learning in the weak sense in the general case. And we will have learning in the strong sense, sorry, if the support of the demand is exactly R plus. And so that concludes what we do in the paper. And to conclude the presentation, just let me note that it's interesting enough that actually the source of informational inefficiency in this game is exactly the same as the source of equilibrium inefficiency in general in routing games. That is the presence of Wheatstone structures embedded in the routing network. So there are many papers dealing about this, and I will be happy to discuss this with you during the Q&A session, and of course, answer any question you may have on my paper. Thank you for your attention.